Good afternoon, and thanks for watching this last Wednesday edition of Bobcat Update. I'm Megan Moore.
And I'm Sarah Cantu. On today's newscast, how text messaging may improve your safety on campus.
And what does hooking up really mean?
People were killed yesterday when a severe storm damaged the homes along the Texas and Mexico border. 81 people were injured, and Maverick County officials said they had feeling that more bodies would be found as searches continued. A funnel cloud was spotted, but the chief dispatcher in the area said straight-line winds may have caused the deaths. The storm also brought intense winds, quarter-size hail, and flash floods.
Students and faculty received an email yesterday about a bomb threat in Flowers Hall. The building was shut down for a couple of hours and reopened at 3:30 after no bomb was found. This past Friday, another email was sent to students and faculty alerting them of a bomb threat in the middle of the night. Students and faculty were asked to stay away from the campus until 6 a.m. These threats come after the massacre at Virginia Tech last week, where 33 people were killed. Texas State University police say they will continue to evaluate all threats to ensure student safety. College students have their eyes glued to their cell phone screens, communicating anytime, any place using text messages. Kirby Routon looked into this text messaging craze and reports in this Bobcat Update.
Texas State students are using text as a way to meet up with friends in the quad or just to find out what's up.
Well, I like text messaging because it's fast to get a hold of people if you need to find something out, and a lot of times people will answer a text over their phone.
In light of the recent shootings at Virginia Tech University, some people are suggesting that text messaging be used as a new mass news source.
Well, text messaging is a valuable way to deliver information to a mass amount of people. What happened at Virginia Tech, where we could use something similar to that to here.
Text messaging has even been used as a political tool in the Texas State Student Government presidential campaigns. But presidential candidate Reagan Pugh says text messaging is an impersonal campaign strategy.
What they chose to do was text message, make phone calls, as opposed to actually meeting people, as opposed to actually talking to people. And I think that for the most part, people found that as an annoyance, as opposed to something that's positive.
Many professors do not allow their students to have cell phones out in class anymore because texting, as college students refer to it, has become such a distraction.
I tell my students they can't have cell phones out in class or anything like that. But as far as a way to reach students, a lot of students in a short time, I think it's a good thing to have.
Though annoying and maybe intrusive at times, text messaging seems to be the most efficient way to get your message out there. For Bobcat Update, I'm Kirby Rowe.
Family and friends of Virginia Tech shooting victim Erin Peterson gathered in Centralville, Virginia yesterday for her funeral. A crowd of more than 400 people paid their respects at Mount Olive Baptist Church. Peterson is one of two victims of last week's attacks who graduated from Westfield High in Chantilly, Virginia. Westfield principal Tim Thomas remembered her as a star athlete, a leader, and a gentle person. Erin Peterson was 19 years old. She was at Norris Hall at Virginia Tech last Monday when a fellow student went on a shooting rampage that left 33 people dead. A man involved in a 15-hour police officer standoff in Austin on Sunday told police that he planned to go on a killing spree that would make the mass murder at Virginia Tech a walk in the park. According to a police affidavit, 23-year-old Jarrell Ortiz Lamar was fighting with his brother over a gun when police drove up. Lamar then shot at the officers and drove to a duplex where he took a woman hostage. When the standoff was over, Lamar set the duplex on fire before police arrested and tasered him. Lamar is charged with attempted murder and capital murder and is in the Travis jail.
Police say a man shot and killed a woman and injured two other people before killing himself at a luxury apartment complex in Houston yesterday. In a news conference, police say it started when the man was served eviction papers. Police say he assaulted the man who served him the papers, shot a neighbor on the way to the complex office, and then fatally shot a woman at the office. After that, he went outside and shot himself. Just last week, the Houston area two people were killed at Johnson Space Center when someone took someone hostage and then killed himself. A young mother of two was killed yesterday in Houston when her truck was hit by a stolen car being chased through a neighborhood by the Houston police. Santos Argueta was working nearby construction when he saw HPD in three cars racing behind the suspect. Argueta says when the suspect tried to turn left, he crashed into the mother's truck. The driver of the stolen car was arrested at the scene. The Houston police have been criticized for high-speed chases for more than 10 years now.
Police in Idaho say a man is in custody after ramming his pickup truck into his estranged wife's home. 48-year-old Eric Marnu was jailed for investigation of aggravated assault and driving while intoxicated. His wife, Caroline, told police the couple is in the process of getting a divorce. She says her husband parked near the house, then demanded that she bring him a cigarette. When she didn't, he rammed the house three times, first hitting the garage and then forcing another truck inside the garage into the house.
Still to come on Bobcat Update, what the hip-hop industry should do about foul language in songs. Stay with us.
Jack is a pretty average guy. Jack just quit smoking. He's doing pretty well. He counters urges in different ways. When he gets a craving, he chews gum. Sometimes he exercises. Jack has even tried brushing his teeth to fight the urge. But sometimes the cravings are a bit stronger. Got a light? Poker night can be a problem. Even a really good meal can bring on an urge. If you're like Jack and find yourself in similar situations, you're not alone. You can call the American Cancer Society's Quit line at 1-877-YES-QUIT, or you can visit their website at www.cancer.org.
According to the University Police Department, vehicular burglaries are on the rise at Texas State. The increase was noticed last week after five burglaries occurred with similar methods of operation. According to an email sent to students last Thursday, late model pickup trucks have been targeted. The burglaries have occurred near Bobcat Stadium, Strahan Coliseum, and Bear Hall. University police encourage students to not leave valuables in plain view in their cars. If you have any information regarding the burglaries or see something suspicious, contact the University Police Department.
In the wake of the controversy that cost Don Imus his job, some inside the hip-hop community are calling for a voluntary ban on the type of language that got the radio host in trouble. Offensive and demeaning words are used in several hip-hop lyrics, but now a leader in the industry, mogul Russell Simmons, says enough is enough. Simmons is part of the Hip Hop Summit Action Network. They say they still defend the artist's use of these words, but they are proposing a voluntary ban on words on public airwaves. Radio host Don Imus was fired following his use of offensive language describing the Rutgers women's basketball team. Simmons says his proposal is all about corporate responsibility, not censorship.
The words Don Imus used are the same words that rap artists use to make millions. Should the artist be held accountable too? Epsilon Williams has more in this Bobcat Update.
Women are very often represented in rap videos wearing inappropriate attire and referred to in a disrespectful manner. Instead of being called women, they are referred to by the names Don Imus used and dressed in sexually suggestive skin-clad outfits. Texas State student Branston Harris says the hip-hop industry needs to do something about it.
That rage and that anger, you know, like growing up in poverty, trying to find a way out, you know, and now it's turned to more of like a show.
Others feel the consumers choose what they listen and watch and can censor themselves.
I think that if people go out of their way to buy the CD, then it's okay for it to be on there because it's their choice to listen to it.
The songs and the artists are legally protected by the First Amendment, but some people feel the artists should take it upon themselves to clean up the airwaves.
I don't think there should be censorship by the government. I think artists themselves should be, or should want to promote a healthier image. And so I don't think it should be censored per se. I just think they should do a better job of depicting women. And
the words you hear on the radio or obscene depictions you see in a live show or music video have shed light on a double standard in society, a double standard the general public feel the hip-hop industry is responsible for and should help change.
Hip-hop began as an energetic art form, but some feel it has changed.
People love music, you know, and if the rappers stop using the words, then eventually, you know, people stop using it as well.
The music industry is a lucrative, profit-driven business, and some feel the artists are just giving consumers what they want.
You know, it's what the consumers wanted, so they manipulated their sales or their what they were selling so that it fits what the world wants, therefore providing them with more money.
One student says the music business just responded to a need from the public.
I think we should go back to being pre-2000 or pre-99 when Cash Money really put out that bling. Cash Money in Louisiana put out that bling. I think we should go before that and go back to the artistic feel that some of the videos used to have.
Former President NSWT alum Lyndon Baines Johnson once said our society will not be great until every young mind is set free to scan the farthest reaches of thought and imagination.
I mean, we live in America. I mean, freedom of speech, even if you don't like the freedom of the speech that you should be protecting is the speech that you hate the most. Or at least that's my opinion.
With this Bobcat update, I'm Epsilon Williams.
Two more shock jocks are off the air because of vulgar, racist, and sexist language. They work for CBS, the same company that fired Don Imus less than 2 weeks ago for his offensive language. This time, the target of the insults were Asians, and CBS let the insults air twice before yanking the jocks off the air. It was a 6-minute phone call prank called into a Chinese restaurant by JV and Elvis of CBS-owned New York radio station. It was aired twice this month. A seemingly unsuspecting employee's accent is mocked. There are sexual innuendos like hot and spicy references to Asian women and jokes about kung fu. Advocacy groups are putting pressure on radio stations to clean up their acts and say they will put pressure on advertisers to make it happen.
A man who is on death row for killing the owners of an Amarillo grocery store 13 years ago is scheduled to be executed tomorrow evening. Ryan Dixon said while attempting to steal beer from the store, a tussle over a .22 caliber rifle occurred and accidentally killed the married store owners. He said he didn't know he had killed the couple until he was told later that night. Dixon will be the 13th Texas inmate to be put to death this year.
There's new evidence that the Pentagon deliberately covered up the circumstances of Army Ranger Pat Tillman's death in Afghanistan after he was killed by so-called friendly fire. A congressional hearing this week featured a video replay of The Big Lie, a phony account of Pat Tillman's heroism given at his memorial service. One ranger, who was with Tillman when he was killed, says his firsthand account was changed and he was ordered to keep quiet. Tillman's brother, Kevin, a fellow ranger, says he believes the deception was deliberate, a crass PR motive. No one to date has been held accountable for the deception.
The high cost of a college education in the U.S. has become a burden to many students and their families. Two-thirds of American students will graduate with debt. Some students owe as much as $50,000. The median is $19,000. Interest rates vary from the federal cap of 6.8% to 20% for private loans. In New York, the Attorney General is accusing universities of making shady deals with certain lenders by taking kickbacks. The Department of Education is now scrambling to explain stock deals and cozy relationships between some of its officials and private lenders. Many students are desperate for the money as tuition prices have soared over 35% in the past 5 years.
On May 12th, San Marcos voters will be asked to approve $14.3 million to finish construction on some of the new area public schools. This comes 3 years after voters approved $122 million for new school construction. Apparently, that money has run out and the school district needs more to complete construction. The need for more money is being blamed on the rising cost of construction materials worldwide. There are 5 schools being built and renovated, and altogether they will come out to $25 million over budget.
Existing home sales posted their sharpest drop in 18 years last month. Sales fell to an annual pace of 6.12 million homes in March. That's down more than 8% from February. Home prices nationwide have been falling for 8 straight months. Home builders are feeling the pinch, too. Permits for new home construction are down 26%. Economists say the combination of winter weather and newly tightened lending standards for people with weak credit contributed to the drop. Housing market conditions are the most depressed in the Midwest, where sales fell 10.9% in March. Some lawmakers in Congress say the nation's food safety system is broken. They are concerned because the number of foodborne illnesses in this country has been increasing. There have been 5,000 serious food outbreaks over the past 15 years, but the Food and Drug Administration still doesn't have the authority to recall food products. Not only that, the FDA has also seen its budget and staff slashed. The agency says it can only inspect 1% of imported food. The FDA isn't the only agency involved in food safety. The government now has 12 different agencies involved, and Congress is considering consolidating the effort.
Well, what's going on in Strahan Coliseum this afternoon? We'll let you know after the break.
When you think of the Texas State Student Recreation Center, this is what you may think of. But what most people don't know is that right behind Old Main on campus is the Aqua Sports Center for those who like to get in a good swim. Like the Student Rec Center, the Aqua Center is open to all students and is available for lap swimming or just recreational swim. Both the Aqua Center and the Student Rec Center ask that you have a valid student ID upon entering. The Rec Center offers features such as an indoor track, 4 wood floor basketball courts, an extensive 6,000 square foot weight room with plenty of equipment to work out your lower or your upper body, 6 wood floor racquetball courts, an extensive area of cardio workout machines, and a cyber cafe where you can log on to the internet, watch TV, or enjoy some refreshments. For more information, call the rec at 512-245-2940 or log on to campusrecreation.txstate.edu.
At this very moment, students are rocking out at a free concert at Strahan Coliseum. Riverfest 2007 started at 2 and will go until 11 tonight. Highlights of the day include musical appearances by Eli Young Band, Bob Schneider, and Aaron Watson. But music is not the only part of Riverfest to enjoy. Festival games will be going on all afternoon, including pie throwing and kite flying contests and other fun activities. The college dating scene is undergoing some transformations. Brandi Williams has more in this Bobcat update.
We hear the term hooking up as part of normal college conversations. It's a term with wide-ranging meanings from simply making out to having a sexual relationship. Laura Sesson Stepp writes in her book Unhooked that young women are doing emotional damage to themselves by getting physical with men they are not dating or may have met for the first time. Stepp also says that this culture of sexual aggression often leaves young women physically and emotionally unsatisfied. However, sociology lecturer Gail Gordon Bouzard says these changes may be due to changing gender roles.
It's becoming more acceptable for, particularly for females, to have what guys have had for a long time, which is to just have fun with a lot of different people.
So with dating taking on a new form, are the old days of courting over?
We don't do courting anymore. We kind of just rush into a relationship. There's no process of getting to know somebody. And back in the day, they called that courtship or courting somebody.
On this college campus, I see more hookups than anything. But Texas State is a small fraction of all the students out there.
Texas State senior John Jacobs says that chivalry may be dead.
People are not thinking longevity. They're thinking of spare the moment, you know. I think of my flesh to be desired right now, right then and right there.
But Texas State sophomore Jade White says meaningful relationships still exist.
There are sometimes when I really think that chivalry is dead, but then when I see some of my really good friends in long-lasting, healthy relationships, it gives me hope for the future.
So whether you call it hooking up, caking, spitting game, or just plain dating, the reasons why we date is what has changed the most.
Courting also came out of kind of expectations of, you know, for women anyway, needing to find the right man who's going to take care of them financially and emotionally.
The dating scene has definitely changed. It's up to each person to decide how to proceed, to decide how serious the connection should be. For Bobcat Update, I'm Brandi Williams.
The newest addition at the Whitliff Gallery is an exhibit about children. Little Heroes features photographs of children and their spontaneity, but the photographers say that nature was their original target, and then they noticed children walking the streets of Mexico. Each photograph was taken in different cities at different points in history and depicts the tough conditions in which children live. This exhibit will be open March 24th through August 10th at the 7th floor of Alkeck Library. Texas State School of Music is preparing for a night to showcase its talented student musicians. The solo classical guitar recital will feature 18 Texas State students who will play 2 musical sections each. Admission is free and the recital will be held tomorrow night at 6 p.m. at the University Performing Arts Center located on the Texas State campus. But the music doesn't stop there. Texas State School of Music has 5 events left this spring semester, including a concert band recital on April 25th and 26th, and a recital from the Jazz Lab Band on April 30th. Well, Megan, Riverfest is still going on. Might take a trip down there, see if I can catch Eli Young Band.
You know what? I think I might join you. So that is all for this last Wednesday edition of Bobcat Update. I'm Megan Moore.
And I'm Sarah Cantu. Thanks for watching, and have a great summer.